Welcome in to the afternoon sports drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado's back in studio as well with Levi Peckinpah here with us on this Wednesday. We're live at Brown's Bottle Shop over here on 128 North Main. Right now, you have the perfect time to come in and find what you're looking for your warm weather drinks. Summer is here. We are past midway through May, almost into June, so make sure you come in and find everything you need. The crew here, John Fransman and Chuck Haley, everyone else will help you out. Many new beers coming in this spring, including new IPAs from Stone Brewing and Six Point Brewing, plus several new IPAs and barrel-aged beers from Dogfish Head. Lots of new brewskis available here at Brown's Bottle Shop. Tommy D is with us on this Wednesday. Tom, what's going on?
Not a whole lot, just kind of adding up the hours with Levi. You know, trying to figure out when Oklahoma State's actually going to throw that first pitch. You know, the first game went 3.5 hours, so that pushed the second game back. TCU is in the sixth inning against Kansas State right now, so that's a little bit encouraging. Kansas State leading at 6-3. Maybe TCU doesn't really have a whole lot of energy to win this game. However, you know, and then we got one more we have to worry about before we get to our game, and we'll see if it comes off anywhere near maybe 8 o'clock or 8:30, but we got to pick up the pace a little bit now.
Yeah, first pitch is tentatively scheduled for 7:30, like you said, but falls in place of where this matchup needs to be. It's the primetime matchup and all that, so people will certainly be waiting around, excited for when it does come along. We'll have a lot more coming up on Bedlam Baseball here in just a bit. We're going to get started today because it happened late in our show yesterday. Oklahoma has officially passed name, image, and likeness bill and has gone through. This is the topic that we've talked about a bunch dating back to last year becoming a reality, and it finally is most likely here going to be the case for the state of Oklahoma, which is the first Big 12 state to enact this into law with college athletes. And you guys know I don't have an issue here with this. Mm-hmm. This is something that, and I want to make this clear for everybody, because, look, is it true that student athletes – you know, have that are on scholarship especially receive more than the average student? Yeah, I mean, absolutely. You know, you get a free education and everything else that comes with being a student athlete, especially when you're with the right sport, too. A lot of extra benefits. But they never actually see any legal mm-hmm. monetary compensation. Now, notice I said legal there. They don't actually see that. Now, and they can have that opportunity, and I've seen the arguments put against it. I guess I fail to see how it's wrong or a big deal for anyone to maximize their earning potential, which is what these players now have that opportunity to do in a legal sense. Because, look, I've said this a long time. If you believe in this idea of a free capitalistic society and a capitalistic market where everybody should be able to earn as much money as possible for what they do, and again, this is not even for, you know, playing your sport or anything like that. It's simply for your name, your image, and your likeness. And that's where I'm like, all right, we're going to talk about the line with amateurs and all that stuff. It doesn't cross it for me until you're actually paying them to play a certain sport. If you're just going to come into a sport and say, all right, you know, we want you here, but here's where you can make money with outside businesses and all this is regulated and it's all good. Now, mind you, some of it will be going back to the school. We're just going to throw that in there as well. But you will have a chance to make money. And that's something that I think is it's kind of pointless at this point to argue back against because it's here. Yeah. It's not like, you know, we're still ways down the road from this thing. It's here. It is absolutely coming for most other states, too, and before too long it'll be just a nationwide acceptance.
Yeah, Oklahoma is the 17th state to pass it. And I will say it is important to note the bill is on its way to Kevin Stitt's desk
right.
to sign it. But, I mean, with the NCAA passing it in July, with the quotes saying that it was urgent that we get this done, because other states, you know, we don't want to lose our athletes to other states when this thing goes live. I don't think Stitt's going to pass on this one. I think he'll sign it, and I think it'll go into effect. I don't have a problem with this. I will say that it is a slippery slope. There's going to, like I said yesterday, I think you're going to see a lot of law firms get involved with universities more so just to monitor things, to make sure that the the advertisement advertising deals that quarterbacks and receivers and running backs and star point guards sign with car dealerships are on the up and up, and they're not just getting free rides to do nothing. That's legitimate, but I'm fine with them benefiting off themselves. I think if you're an athlete that fills the seats, like if Cade Cunningham were here last year, like I'm fine because and there's no pandemic and the NIL went into effect last July instead of this July, and Cade Cunningham it would be the reason that gym is packing out night in and night out. There's no reason that he can't make money off of himself. Now I don't think that universities should pay schools pay players, because that's where you cross over from amateur to pro, and that's where the slippery slope is. You know, trying to define where the money's coming from and all that stuff. But I think they should absolutely be able to benefit off themselves, and I don't think that the school should get a portion of the pie, because especially with what Georgia did. Georgia can take up to 75% of an athlete's earnings and redistribute it to other athletes. I'll keep saying it. It's not the quarterback's responsibility to make sure that the third string javelin thrower has enough money to pay rent. That's not on the quarterback.
Well, I hear both of your arguments, and I will say this. I'm not as against it as I am against the hypocrisy of trying to maintain that college athletics is an amateur endeavor. You might as well just pay players. Just pay them a salary. Because if you allow them to go make money on their own, that's basically what they're doing. I don't care if there's a cap on it or not. And I think you guys are a little naive to think that, you know, you're going to be able to cap it and say you can only make $10. And that
somebody
might give
them
20 or 25.
Make as much as you want.
Yeah. No.
Yeah, make as much as you want.
I'm talking, yeah. But if there's a cap to make it look like we're not going to turn you loose and let you be a full-time employee, then that's a hypocritical stance. If somebody can make $100,000, and I don't think everybody who laces up the cleats or the sneakers is going to make millions. I mean, I think we're a little naive to think that everybody on every roster is going to make money. Some may make a little bit here or there, but it's still going to be the celebrities, if you will, who are going to knock down the big bucks. I just think this is just another step in the hypocrisy of what we're doing with college athletes. And I disagree with the fact that maybe a school, I don't think a school should be able to come in and get 50% or whatever the thing is. But keep in mind, I mean, if the kid wasn't playing at your school and wearing your uniform, then he wouldn't be in a position to make that money. So it's kind of a two-way street. He's not just doing this out of his house, and he's got no affiliation. The school is instrumental in the success that this individual might have on the market. So if there's a percentage that goes back to the school, and I'm not saying it should be 75% or anything like that, I'm not against that, but if you're going to turn kids loose to go out and make all the money they can make, then basically you ought to treat them as an employee, and I'm not so sure that the government eventually won't do that and start taxing the money you make, because I don't know if the government's going to care that you should be able to promote your own name, image, and likeness. If you're making a buck off it, Uncle Sam's probably going to tax it somewhere along the way, so I'm okay with that. You can't have it both ways. You can't be an amateur when you don't want to be taxed, and you don't want to be an amateur when you want to make all the money you can. So I'm divided on this thing. I don't think it really does any good to be divided, because it's going to be here. Schools had an opportunity to cut it, you know, nip it in the bud, and they didn't, because they're scared to death that it's going to steer recruits away. Now, you tell me that this is a good solution here. For you to pass this, knowing full well that school's going to use it against you, or you're going to use it against other schools. You come here, I can assure you, quote unquote, you can make $10,000. We got some people lined up that want to use your name, image, and likeness. And you just came from a place that said, hey, you know, the best we can do for you, Zach, is come up with $2,000. Well, Zach's probably going to say, well, there's an $8,000 difference. I'm going to go to Patrick's school. So it opens up a hell of a lot of doors, that you're going to have to handle. I don't know that schools have legal teams that handle that. I don't know who's going to jump up and monitor it. They got all they can do to monitor what they monitor, which is making sure you don't cheat along the way when you recruit. But I think when you start allowing dollars to cross the hands of student athletes, all of a sudden they're not student athletes. They're employees of either the university, the athletic department, or the sport, and they ought to have to adhere to that status. They're no longer amateurs when they can go out and raise their own money.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I can kind of see where you're trying to come from there. To me, I would draw the line, though, when I'm talking about being an amateur, is if we were actually paying you to play a sport.
You scored three touchdowns, so we give you $3,000.
Or you play this many games, you know, and you get paid for this many games. And then that's not the case. You're getting paid for your name, image, and likeness from outside businesses. So that, to me, is where, you know, I see the line of amateurism can be muddled. Also, to your point, Tom, that's, you know, yes, there is an advantage, competitive advantage for schools. The NCAA has basically had to, at this point, beg for national legislation on this. But once again, like the NCAA so often does, they've waited so long that this is all of a sudden coming back and putting them in a corner where they know there's going to be a lot of individual battles to fight. But with the whole amateur thing, that's where I come from, Tom. You don't see it that way. You say that as soon as they get money, even if it is simply for their name, image, and likeness from an outside business, that to you makes them a professional player.
Well, in essence, yes. And when you start signing on with corporations or groups that this is what they specialize in, where they're going to help, we're going to help maximize the dollar for every student athlete. So you sign on with us, and we'll direct those student athletes in the direction they need to go to maximize what they're going to make. When you're mixing dollars with amateurism, in my mind, and I don't have if that's where you want to go with this. And that's where college athletics wants to go. I don't have any problem with that. Let them go. Let's just go all the way and allow kids to go play for whatever they play for. And that's the case. I don't, you know, being against it isn't going to make any difference. But I do think I have a hard time getting in my own mind how you can say that you're still an amateur operation when you allow money to change hands when athletes go out and raise their own money. I mean, remember, before you guys came on, you know, the schools would say, well, you know, people would say, well, how come Johnny, the quarterback, can't work at Walmart? You know, why can't he go raise other money? Well, you know, he's got to work 24/7 with us, you know, 7 days a week. He's got to get in the playbook. He's got to do it. Well, obviously, he must have enough money, time on his hand now, to go sign autographs, to promote shoot a commercial to promote something. Yeah, so obviously they're going to have enough time to do that. And I have no problem with it. If that's the direction you're going, let's not be hypocritical and try to pull this off as still being amateur. Because when this money can change in hands, you're basically helping the money change and the guy's an employee when he's starting to play for money on a college level. And that's what they're doing.
But the money isn't changing hands from school to player. And school is the organization that houses these players that play their sport. So if that were to be actually happening, that's what the NCAA is going off of, and the legislators that are making these laws and putting them into actual circulation, well, they're saying, just like we saw yesterday with Oklahoma, we want to make sure this is clear. This is still an amateur sport. This is still an amateur business because the teams that they're playing for, the universities that they are playing for, are not physically directly paying them to play a sport. And that, to me, mm-hmm. is the definition of being a professional in whatever you do. It's every other business as well, not even just sports. But simply what the university is basically a regulator at this point. They're not somebody that is doing the direct payment and anything like that and aiding in it. They are simply regulating it and making sure everything goes by the rules that are now in place. And that, to me, is where we talk about, all right, we're going to keep it there with that amateur label. It may be a flimsy label a little bit. I'm not saying it's just a firm line in the sand by any means. But I still believe that they are correct in making that happen, because if they couldn't back that up, the NCAA would obviously become obsolete and they wouldn't have any say in anything that went on.
Here's hoping, right? And that's where influencer comes in. You'll see a lot of schools that are hiring companies like influencer. And I think, honestly, I've heard Robert talking about it. I think you're going to see more social media posts, you know, than anything, more just product promotion through Twitter and through Instagram and stuff like that. Now you'll get the off-season autograph signings and you'll get the off-season commercial shoots and stuff, but I think you'll see more promotion. And that's the biggest hang up for me is like, Tom, I'll ask you this question, because you've experienced more amateur sports than I have. What's the big hang up with amateurism versus professional sports? And I'm with you. If the direction they want to take is professional football in college, then that's fine. You know, if that's what you want to make it, then let's, you know, so be it. But what's the big hang up there? Not just for you, but just in general for amateurism versus professional.
Well, my hang up is a lot less now than it ever has been. I mean, it's mm-hmm. closer to being pro than it is anything else.
Absolutely.
And more so than it was even 10, 15 years ago. And if that's the direction people want to go, that's fine. I'm not bucking the direction.
Right.
Obviously, there's enough people who think this is the way to go. But let's not stand on a sanctimonious stage and preach amateurism, because amateurism was encompassed by you go to a school, you get a scholarship, maybe you work in the summer, you know, on the road crew back home and make some extra money. But now, obviously, you can't, since you got to live with Rob Glass for the summer. I'm just using football as an example. So now you can't do that. Well, if you're going to let guys go out and do their own thing and make their own money, and maybe there's a cap, maybe there's not, maybe it's control, maybe it's not. The problem I have with it, I went through it before it became this way, when overzealous people, and I don't care what they say in a contract, if the contract says I can only pay Zach the going wage, whatever it is, and $5 an hour to promote my product, whatever they come up with. I've seen it work where I like what Zach did on the court the other night. So you're going to get $5, but you think I'm going to tell the school that I'm giving you 25 more? Hell no. They'll never know. The only people who'll know is me and you. And I'm not going to say anything, and you probably aren't going to say anything either. When you start transferring money around a little bit in that regard, then you open yourself up for these kinds of things. And we went on probation for that back in the 70s here, because of the, you know, $100 handshakes. So I guess I'm jaded in my approach there. I don't put the trust in everybody saying, we're going to be abide by the rule now. We're not going to do anything. Because there's always somebody out there in a fan base or in a donor base that's enamored with a kid that just thinks, and maybe in their own mind, maybe this is not a bad, you know, I could help him or her. So I'll give him a little extra. The school's not going to know that, fellas. You can't monitor that, because
I agree, Tom. But that's never said that it would be, you know, going down completely by the book.
To me, that's where the slippery slope.
There's
comes
always going to be issues like that, whether they come to light or not. I mean, there still is. So I mean, that aside, this is how it is, and I understand that there's going to be problems with it here and there. And of course, we may run into, you know, if a cap is set or whatever, and we find out, well, you know, you were given extra and you knew about it. Yeah, we're going to run into some more scandals. Of course, this isn't going to fix mm-hmm. that problem. But when you talk about what players did when they came in beforehand, and, you know, they had to work in the off season, that type of thing, or work when they weren't playing just to make money and all this, is for these players doing what they do and what they're going to do with advertising, you know, making appearances, social media, should that not also be considered somewhat of work? I mean, they're doing something separate and in place to, you know, of what they did making money. They might not be bagging groceries, but they're putting a post on Twitter, actively promoting a brand and getting paid for it. To me, that counts as work.
And that's where I could see, I think you're right. That's where I could see the NCAA. I don't think it should be that way. Because if, you know, let's just say if Tylan Wallace can go out and make $2 million while he was still at Oklahoma State, then that Tylan Wallace should be able to go out and make $2 million. But when you get the NCAA, when they finally quit dragging their feet and they finally figure it all out and they start passing their stuff, I could absolutely see the NCAA coming out and saying, okay, guys, across the board, men's and women's sports, you can't make more than $250,000 in a calendar year or $200,000 or whatever. I could absolutely see the NCAA doing that, because that's what the NCAA does. And I could see the NCAA coming out and saying, okay, so – Okay. Oklahoma State is not directly paying the players, but I would have to think that Oklahoma State and other universities with influencer and other, they'll be the middleman.
Exactly. Know? That's what I said. Yeah, the regulator.
The money will pass through them, and I could see the NCAA coming out and saying, okay, you know, Oklahoma State, you're not paying players, but you get a finder's fee and you're a member of the NCAA. So we're, you know, whatever the university brings in for student athletes, you keep X amount for fees, and then we take X amount of that as, well, we're the NCAA and you're a member school.
You don't think it's inherently dangerous when...
That's what I'm saying, yeah. No, I don't agree with it, but I can see the NCAA doing it.
You don't think it's inherently dangerous when teams are starting to drop the hints that if we don't do this in the state of Oklahoma, then we're going to lose players to the state of Texas?
And well, that's why they passed the bill yesterday.
Okay, but you don't think that inherently tells you that there's some leverage going to be going on between the schools and recruits, and you can use...
No, absolutely.
No, so is there? That's why the NCAA is begging for this legislation to be passed on the national level so that they can have this for all universities. But they've waited so long that now you've got a bunch of different states, what, 17 now individually?
Yep, 17. That are with Kansas and Texas looking at
it now. Pending. They're taking the approach, and they all realize what we realize. It's do or die right now, because whether you consider it fair or not to be having a competitive advantage by doing this, that's what I said. It's here. You better jump on the train while you have that opportunity right now.
Yeah, I guarantee that Oklahoma State, you know, Mike Gundy, when that June recruiting dead period ends and you get players on campus, I'm sure there will be guys on official visits the middle of June that Gundy and staff are like, hey, listen, you know, July 1, yeah, if you come to Oklahoma State, that school you're looking at 600 miles away in a state that doesn't have NIL, you can come here and you can make money.
And, Tom, give me your thoughts on this real quick, because I know we got to go. But real quick, the thing I see being the biggest hang-up eventually with this, too, has to do with Title IX. Because you're going to have, if there's not a big-time regulation put in place, which, of course, there may be at some point.
That's the Georgia
rule. Yeah, you're going to have, you know, quarterbacks, point guards on men's teams making a lot more money than the women do. That's just how – we already know that's how it's going to go. But I could see a lot of issues stemming from that, saying, hey, there's no reason over here – that's going to be the argument. There's no reason the women's team shouldn't see as much money as the men's.
And on paper, that's correct. There's no reason for that. But now you're into free enterprise again. I mean, the people who want you advertising or pushing a product or whatever, they're the ones in control. They may not want a woman doing it. They may not want somebody in soccer or women's basketball to do it. But they sure as hell going to sit in line for Spencer Sanders. I mean, that's just free enterprise. I don't know. I think the two hang-ups you're going to have, you mentioned lawyers. I mean, what if you put a cap on it? How long will it take first lawyer to jump up and say, you have no right to tell my client, in this case a student athlete, that he could only make X amount of money? You've already said he can make the money. You've already opened the door to that. What makes you think that you could just put a limit on how much he makes? And I think that's number one's going to be a problem. And the Title IX thing might work itself out. I don't know. Probably there's a group of people that will want female athletes to do what you guys are talking about, social media, all that stuff. But will they make that kind of money? And I'll throw this out before we hang it up here. You know, I think this is kind of like the one-and-done thing fear. When that first came around, you know, oh, my goodness, one-and-done. Everybody's going to have – they're going to lose three or four guys in the roster, and we won't have any players. And it was a choice few that actually were one-and-done and left after 1 year and went to play, and some made it, some didn't. I'm not sure this is going to be an across-the-board thing. I'd be interested in what the percentage is of athletes who actually make money off their name, image, and likeness, because you got to have something to sell, right? And if you're not one of the top players in any sport, then you don't have much to sell to me, so thus your value to me is not very good.
And that's what worries me about what Georgia did. In their NIL state law, They signed it in that the universities can take up to 75% of whatever the athlete makes, and they redistribute it to the other athletes upon graduation.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. Like this, Spencer Sanders. If let's just say hypothetically that happened in Oklahoma.
Yeah,
it's not Spencer Sanders job and position to make sure that cross country and track and equestrian make money.
Right. And that's probably tied in with a little bit to avoid Title IX issues. I mean, it just probably is. We will inevitably revisit this topic at some point again when this continues to grow. When we come back on the Afternoon Sports Drive, we'll take a look at Bedlam baseball going on this evening next on the Afternoon Sports Drive. Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado, here on this Wednesday afternoon, live from Brown's Bottle Shop over here, 128 North Main. If you like to try different beers, check out the sampler six packs from Woodchuck Cider or a 12 pack of beer from Beer Camp World Samplers by Sierra Nevada as well at Brown's Bottle Shop. You can come in and just try a bunch of different ones. You don't have to choose. You can find your favorite, get a little bit of variety, and they have that available over here at Brown's and get you ready for your summer.
You know what else they have?
What's that?
Sake.
They have a lot of sake over here.
Yeah. We had someone climb over our table to get some.
You know what? Maybe they're onto something.
Yeah.
I will admit, I've never had sake myself, so maybe they are on something. I don't know. I should ask them.
Yeah.
So, hey, what was the, what's the draw?
What's that taste like?
Like, listen, it's going to change your life if you try this. Like, well, all right. Let me try it out.
I could use with a life change.
Yeah, why not? Just a little change.
Yeah.
But, over here you can find whatever you want. Even sake is available at Brown's Bottle Shop. All right, so tonight, Bedlam baseball. I would say less than 4 hours from now, but I'm probably feeling pretty hopeful on that. 7:30 is the first pitch scheduled tonight in matchup number 6.
Certainly before 10 o'clock.
Yeah, let's hope. if it's not before 10 o'clock, something has gone horribly wrong in the prior games and up to that point. 7:30 attempt to pit first pitch tonight, again, matchup number 6. Now, this is a game where you, I think, are going to expect this is like intensity every single pitch, and it's going to be a complete turnaround from the last time these two teams met, where it was we're going to throw everybody we have out there and see if we can't get a win, and Oklahoma State was able to do that. This is completely different. It's best against best. Every single pitch is important. Every single at-bat, you can't take one off type of thing. So obviously a lot of excitement tonight for this matchup, and it's going to be a big-time night and big-time opportunity for Justin Campbell, who I would have to think, Tom, right now, the Cowboys feel just about as confident as him on the mound as they do anybody.
Yeah, if you had to just pick somebody that you wanted to win a game and needed to win the game, whatever that is, it would certainly be Campbell. He's acquitted himself well. They've seen him once already. He went 5 innings, I believe, and gave up a couple of runs, 7 hits. So they've seen him before during the regular season. I believe he started that second game in the first game in Norman, second of the series. And we lost that one 5-3, I think. I think he gave up a home run to Squires, if his memory serves me correctly. But, it's on his shoulders, but I think the ballpark probably fits him well. As I told Steve this morning, brick, you can take it out of brick, for sure. I'm not saying home runs won't come, but if you keep the ball in the gap, center to gap to gap, it's a big yard. And if you if you throw off-speed pitches where guys are out in front of the ball and don't square a fastball up, a lot of those long fly balls and brick go to die in the gaps, And it'll be nighttime. It won't carry as much as it does during the day. I'm watching this game here, the TCU at Kansas State game. They had a couple in the alley that went off the wall. So in the day, it gets a little easier. But, there's a lot on the line for this thing. I mean, take Bedlam aside. Which you can't, because when the two teams meet. But, I'm thinking this is do or die for Oklahoma in terms of the NCAA tournament. And since Baylor got spanked at the 9 o'clock game, and now they're in the loser's bracket and could go 0-2, depending on who they play here, at Kansas State and TCU are tied at 6 in the 7th, all of a sudden now, Oklahoma could make the claim that, we are 5th. Well, they tied with Baylor for 5th, but they got it because they took 2 out of 3 from Baylor. And then maybe, they have a better thing going right now than Baylor does. I looked at the RPIs. Baylor's at 40 and has a strength of schedule at 48, but Oklahoma's at 54, has a strength of schedule of 19. So, you know, these next 2 days may dictate whether Oklahoma's for real, and Skip Johnson doesn't have to plead his case in the media like he's done the last couple of days, that I don't see how they could slap us in the face and not take us. Well, you know, you had a chance for 24 games not to be 11-13, but I think there's an urgency for them, no question about it. There's an urgency for Oklahoma State, and don't get me wrong, whenever you're playing Oklahoma, and I think Holiday's record would indicate he's 25-9, so there's always an urgency when a Holiday team takes on Oklahoma. And there'll be an urgency tonight, but there's a little bit more pressure on the Sooners because, in my mind, they're not going anywhere unless they win this tournament, and they're not going to win this tournament unless they win tonight. In my mind, they don't have enough to get through the loser's bracket. Keep in mind, if you win the first game, you only have to win three more to get to Sunday and win it. If you drop into the loser's bracket, you can win five more. And very few teams in this league have that kind of pitching to go five games and get to Sunday. So this is a crucial game for both teams concerned. They'll play it that way. There's no secrets. Everybody's seeing each other. They know what you do, what you don't do, how well you do it, how well you don't. How you pitch it, who you pitch. So there's no secrets when you play five games in the year, even though I throw the first one and the last one out, because those were just Johnny Holstaff, non-conference, and that wasn't what you're going to see when you get into the weekend. The only games that meant anything to me were the weekend games, and they took two out of three and kicked our ass the first game up here.
All right, Zach. Real quick, then let's go prediction mode. Well, what do we got? What'll be like tonight? We're gonna have more on in game stuff coming up, but let's go score.
Well, it's like we talked about yesterday with our buy or sell. I think it'll be a high scoring game. I don't know if we're gonna see double digits from either team, but I could easily see 8-6, 9-6, 8-7 type of game. I would take Oklahoma State. They're healthy. They ended the season really hot, and that's really, really important for baseball. So I'll take OSU. Let's go 8-5.
Okay, 8-5. 8-5. 8-5 for Zach. Tom, what do you like prediction-wise here?
I like kind of like we had in that last game in Norman. It was 8-7. We won it, and showed a lot of discipline to get it into extra innings. I could see it doing that. Both teams know each other. I think they'll have both teams will be up some, down some within the game itself. I think Oklahoma State's bullpen, when you stretch it out, is better than Oklahoma's. So if you can get through their top two guys that they throw tonight, Ruffcorn and anybody else, you got a chance of taking it to the finish line against their bullpen. Better than I think they can take it to ours. So and it's a negligible difference. So I think that will be the difference. So I could see us winning an 8-7 game in 9 or 10 innings.
But please God, don't let it go extra.
Well, what do you care? You'd be at home. You're not there. What do you care how long it goes?
How do you know I'm not going to be there?
Hey, I can bet $100 that you're not going to be there.
You'll find out.
Lancaster, you aren't Levi, going anywhere.
He's not. Levi, what prediction do you have?
I think it's also going to be a very close game, going all the way down to probably the final inning. I'm kind of around the same range as Tom. I'm going to go instead of 8-7, I'll go 8-6, Oklahoma State.
Yeah, I'm pretty much around you guys. I like it to be a 7-5 final score. For Oklahoma State. I'm with Tom, though. I expect it back and forth. You know, you've got momentum swings probably from first inning on because these are two teams. While Oklahoma does lack at times pitching, they can swing the bat, and certainly Oklahoma State can too. You know, their lineup is potent. 1-9, and a lot of guys feeling it right now. Talked about Carson McCusker yesterday, really coming off of a nice series against, I know it was New Orleans, but still, that's got to feel good coming into this game, as a lot of the hitters were, so there's going to be a lot of excitement. Again, tonight in Oklahoma City, first pitch scheduled for 7:30, but most likely will be later past that time. Coming up next on the Afternoon Sports Drive, we'll take a look, we'll stick with baseball, but we'll take a look at one big story out of Major League Baseball happening last night. That's up next, Triple Play Sports Radio. Showed you true colors, I don't like what I see. Story keeps changing, I know what that means. Know what that means, I know what that means. How'd you go from being that somebody I believed into being someone that was me behind the scenes? Can't forget.
sorry that I ain't never received. I mean, least you could have done was gave me an apology, but you're so prideful.
Welcome back into the afternoon sports drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado, and Levi Peckinpah are rocking it in the studio. We're live at Brown's Bottle Shop, 128 North Main, over 3,000 wines at Brown's Bottle Shop, and they continue to add new ones. Great warm weather refreshers and flavored wines from Echo Falls, combining peach with mango or strawberry, raspberry, and blackberry. It just screams warm weather. So make sure to come get your hands on a bottle here at Brown's Bottle Shop. All right, so last night in Major League Baseball, we got to see the rematch here with the Astros and the Dodgers, the rematch that we all need, of course, stemming from the cheating scandal in the World Series. And Clayton Kershaw pitching last night, he dominated. Had a very, very good outing. And this is his quote, okay, because, of course, it was asked after the game, hey, was there a little bit of extra motivation for you to go seven-plus innings and pitch really well and end up getting a victory against the Astros? And his quote was, it's a hard one to answer. I was kind of thinking about it, just like what it felt like being there tonight, pitching again after the World Series in 2017. I don't really know how to express it. It did feel like a little more like an important game, but maybe – it was just because it was a full crowd, unquote. And I'm thinking, wait a second. Maybe it was because it was a full crowd? That was the difference? You were so amped up and ready? No. It wasn't that at all. It was you going out there, and 2017 is not out of your mind. Plain and simple, and you went out there and you dominated, and you had a little extra motivation because these are the team that basically stole a World Series from you. And most Dodgers players, okay, they were asked after the game a lot of the same questions. Justin Turner and the like, and all of them basically tried to act like they moved on. And I'm thinking, you know, that's nice. You know, let's get out there in the media and make it to where it's like, yeah, you know, we're over it. It's you know, it happened, and then the punishment for the team didn't really go the way we wanted. The players obviously didn't get punished, but you know, we're moving on. I'm like, I just don't believe that. I don't buy that for a second. I feel like if these two teams were to play every single game together, you know, against each other the rest of the season, it would be, I mean, back and forth every single game, and we would have drama because it would inevitably stem from it. Why? Because players haven't moved on. But I thought that Dave Roberts said it best when he was asked when baseball fans will move on from this. And he goes, quote, I don't know, the world doesn't really appreciate cheating. And I thought that was about the best way to put it, because we don't appreciate cheating, especially to that level. And so while you might have players and you might have the occasional management admit that, hey, you know, we're past it, we're moving on, I don't buy it for a second. I don't know about you guys, but it doesn't, you know, it's not something that I can see them just, here we are, in 2021, and they've just fully accepted and moved on. That's one thing you would never fully accept.
I could see in, like, over 3 or 4 years, you know, players start to – yeah, I'm still upset about it, but it is what it is. But I don't think it'll be by the end of this year. And honestly, I don't – depending on how this year goes with the Astros, I could see them holding a grudge next year. But once we get to, like, the end of 22 or into 23, I could be like, yeah, y'all some cheaters. But, you know, it is what it is. Now it starts to be water under the bridge a little bit.
Yeah, I don't think – I mean, I'm not one of these conspiracy guys, okay? It's hard enough to play the game as it is. I think they were all trying to be politically correct. Are they still harboring ill will? Sure. Are they still harboring their own private thoughts about it? Sure. And that may go on till they retire and get out of the game. And even after that, somebody's got to write a book about it, right? And got to write a book back. You know, I remember 25 years ago when they cheated. But what good does it do to keep it on the front burner now once it's over? I mean, you just go out and beat their ass and just get on to the next one, like Kershaw did. And I don't know that you don't get any extra ticks in the win column because you beat the Astros. You get one, all right? And you don't get any more because you beat the cheaters. I just don't think, you know, I think they try to put it away the best they can, but you got people who won't let it die and people who want to keep it on the front burner, like somebody I know, constantly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're doing God's work.
And I don't know why that's even that important to you. I mean, nobody's going to forget what they did. Nobody's going to forget what they did. And for people to say, well, it's, you know, it's done. I don't think that'll ever be the case. And once they get out of the game, Katie barred the door. There'll be all kinds of books and interviews and really saying what they really wanted to say. But, you know, I think it's for the best of the two teams and the best of the game, and that you don't that shouldn't be what you throw out there as our only motivation of winning, because the Dodgers, you know, they're in a dogfight to stay in that in the lead in their division. Every game's important, whether it's the Astros or the Mets. So does it feel better for Kershaw that he won? Yeah, but he was probably as politically correct as you could be. But I don't think anybody's going to ever forget that it happened, and you're not going to forget your feelings about it, I don't think. But that shouldn't be the reason you're playing the game, though.
No, and I don't think it should be reason, you know, enough to be like, ah, this is the only reason we'll go out there and win, because clearly it's not. It's probably one of the main ones, though. And I disagree. I think it is good for the game right now. It keeps an interesting aspect to that rivalry. You're going to draw more fans to that every single time they play. And this was obviously elevated back when last year when Joe Kelly did what he did. I mean, that really amped it all back up, and kind of, you know, we had to get a nice reminder of it and solidified the rivalry and everything, all the drama. So I think it is good for a game that needs, is always complaining about not enough viewers for certain games and things like that, not enough entertainment value. We want to get people involved. Okay, well, this is a great way to do it. Let's keep this flame alive in this rivalry. Let's always bring up the stuff that happened with the Astros. Let's never let it die that they did cheat, and they did so in such a heinous way that it resulted in a stolen World Series. That's exactly what happened. And I will stand by that forever. And especially, like you said, after these guys retire, that's kind of what I was thinking. The Astros players, maybe it's when it finally starts to die down a little bit. I don't know. I'd still be, kind of surprised if it did. This is something like we've never seen. And you had a ton of Dodgers fans last night in a packed out. It was like 35,000 at Minute Maid. And a ton of Dodgers fans, whether they, you know, flew across the country to get there or they were just there already in Texas.
Bunch of Ranger fans.
Yeah, Rangers fans just looking for Dodger a new gear. Team. Yeah, just going in. But they had the chant of cheaters, cheaters going so loud. You know, it was throughout the entire ballpark, and that's amazing. And I credit the fans for never letting the flame die out, as it were.
That sounds like high school ball, man. I mean, if you need your fans to be saying cheaters, cheaters, to make it a game that's of noteworthiness, then we've really gone over the cliff here. I understand where you're coming from, although I really don't understand your stake in it, because you're not a fan of either. So all of a sudden, I guess you're self-righteous.
I'm a fan of not cheating, though.
You're a self-righteous son of a gun. So I guess that's where you're going, but. You know, maybe you should be the commissioner, perhaps.
Maybe I should.
But
maybe
you know what?
I can guarantee you, Tom, if I was, the punishment actually would have fit the crime. That's for damn sure.
Well, that's your opinion. We all have opinions, right?
Are you going to change the baseball?
And I don't agree with yours. Let it go, man. I don't know. What is it? What does it benefit other than your 2 hours a day that you can bring it up and talk about? What does it benefit to continue to have that on the front plate all these years later? What's the benefit? You think people wouldn't get excited to go watch Kershaw pitch, whether it was the Astros or not?
Yeah, they would, but you're telling me that the idea of reminding everyone what happened and making it a part of the game and the chants and all that good stuff and the fake trash cans and all that, you're telling me that that's something that wouldn't enhance the environment a little bit and the viewing experience? I mean, come on, you think it would.
What? Now we're getting it. I see where you come from, because this reeks of the NFL. This is why you like the NFL, because it's a sideshow. I don't see any reason to turn baseball into a sideshow. How many people do you think don't know what happened, that they need Patrick Wheeler to come on the radio and remind them it happened? I think anybody who followed it knew it happened. So
sure,
why do you have to bring it up again when you're playing them again?
Because the main story out of last night was that Clayton Kershaw was asked about it, and you had all these guys trying to act like that it was completely over. And I just don't buy that. There's absolutely no way that they are over it.
Now,
over
how would you
and,
know
and
that?
Were being
Do you know
correct.
Every one of those guys? Do you know every
no,
one of those guys?
No, but I'm saying, in my opinion, there is no way they were being completely honest about all that it's water under the bridge. There is absolutely no way. They stole a World Series from them. I mean, I don't care how many years it is later. That's a ring. We always like to compare things. We always like to compare teams, you know, and the first thing we go to is, well, what kind of – what? How many championships? You know, what have they done in the postseason? It was stolen away from them. I mean, seriously, that's something we can't bring up. It's not like it was some mid-series, some mid-season series that means nothing. It was the World Series, for crying out loud. There's a lot that goes on there. It means a ton.
Well, you go ahead and fan the flame. I'm not going to join that bandwagon because the game is tough enough without you having to beat the drum, no pun intended, to get the rivalry back up again. I'd just soon go see Kershaw stick it in their ear and win a game if I was a Dodger fan and not be too concerned about a World Series that I didn't win. I mean, who won last year? I mean, it's not like the Dodgers are not going to win anymore, right? This is one more.
Right.
So you're going to sit there and say, oh, my goodness, instead of winning 25, they only won 24 because they got cheated. I mean, let it go, man. It doesn't affect the game at all. It doesn't affect the game of baseball at all.
Not at this time, but it did.
Well, why should it do now? I mean, we're all those years past it.
Because the lack of punishment that was not doled out is something I've told you this a billion times, Tom. If you had actually had the correct punishment, I wouldn't talk about this one more time. I would still be ticked off that it was stolen away. And this is for the Dodgers. You know me. I don't like the Dodgers. I can't stand most of the Dodgers. But I refuse to sit by and just act like, Astros are fine. You know, all these players that cheated are still in the league, and it's no big deal. You know, let them be. And if they would have been punished correctly, and if the ring would have been taken away, you would have never heard another word from me. But the fact that it was not, and you have an asterisk next to this World Series that is forever tainted, is something that I just cannot stand to see, especially with these players still getting to be in the league and do what they're doing.
Well, I'd take their word over yours, and if they don't really care at this stage of the game, it's just an irritation, but it's not a driving force, then I think I would go that route and get off what you're on, because, you know, I guess they ought to start checking with you when they start making decisions in the MLB to see if you like it or not. I just don't see what good it does for you to carry it on 4 years later when everybody knows. It's not like you're breaking a story, Patrick, every day you bring it up. Everybody knows what happened. They know exactly what happened, and in some cases, they know what did not happen as far as taking it away. But it's under the bridge. Why keep bringing it up again when it really makes no difference in what's going to happen this year?
And I know we got to go, but it was just so egregious. It's something that I have a hard time letting go of, a game that we always complain about, the purity and all this stuff and everything involved in it. Well, it was a blatant cheating scandal that was gone unpunished, and it's something that I refuse to turn a blind eye to. You may be more forgiving than I am, Tom. That might just be how it is, but I refuse to take the high road on this one. Unfortunately for some people. All right, coming up next on the Afternoon Sports Drive, now we're number two, we're going to get into some buy or sell here on Triple Play Sports Radio. And I don't know how we make it out when we make out on the low. Even if it rains, you'd rather make it snow. Both you and me know we gotta let it go. Laying on the ground, wondering why it's so cold. How we make it out when we make out on the low. Even if it rains, you'd rather make it snow. Both you and me know we gotta let it go. Laying on the ground, wondering why it's so cold. Why you so icy cold? My tears can't drip.
Welcome back in hour number two of the Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado, and Levi Peckinpah along with us as well. We're live at Brown's Bottle Shop, 128 North Main. You can come in and find new red blends, wines by Game of Thrones, Buckshack, and Seven Moons. They have new Chardonnays from 19 Crimes, Dreaming Tree, and of course Game of Thrones has their own in that as well. Your one-stop shop for the best beers, wines, and spirits, as well as pre-mixed cocktails, all available here at Brown's Bottle Shop. So getting started here with the second hour, we're going to get into some buy or sell.
Are you buying?
I'd buy that for a dollar.
Or are you selling?
You'll pick up the phone and you'll sell, sell, sell.
This is Buy or Sell on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Make money, money, make money.
Buy or Sell Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network with Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado, and Levi Peckinpah. All right, so the first one I have for you guys, I'm going back to the diamond tonight. OSU baseball taking on Oklahoma. We talked about Justin Campbell, and I'm pretty sure I know your guys' answer on this one based off our previous conversation. I'll still throw it out there. Buy or sell, Justin Campbell goes at least six innings in tonight's matchup.
I would probably sell it based on my score prediction, but I don't think it'll be because he's given up a lot of unearned runs. You know, I think it'll be, a lot of earned runs, rather. I think he'll have a decent outing. You know, I think he'll perform well, but I think it's going to be one of those where you're going to see a lot of arms tonight on both sides. I would sell six. I could see him going four and a half, maybe five, but probably not too much more after that.
I think I'd buy it. He averages about six in a game, and we don't need to be in. This is not going to be a Johnny Holstaff game, okay? If we're running pitchers out there on our side, at every couple of innings, that won't be a good sign for OSU. And I don't think that's the case. I don't think Campbell will give it up that way. So I'll buy that he's in there at least six innings. And I don't think they're going to have tremendous success off of him. They didn't down in Norman. They just had enough to run his pitch count up. I was looking at his pitch count when he was down there. You know, he threw 103 pitches in five innings. Now, they're good enough at doing that. They can put the bat on the ball. They foul off a lot of pitches. They have a lot of two-runner innings. And they find a way to get runners on and extend your pitch count. But he's a strong dude now. And he's of all the guys we got going to the mound, he's probably the best Stone is good at throwing the ball over the plate and getting people to hit first pitches. But these guys are pretty disciplined. So I would say he'd be there at least six innings, I would think.
Yeah, and I'm going to buy as well. You know, a lot of it is going to Justin Campbell's durability, his ability to stay within himself on the mound. And, yeah, it's contingent, certainly, on pitch count. If he can keep at bats low, even keep inning totals low, not walking a lot of guys is going to be huge with that as well. And that's why I can see him going in there. I could even, you know, I like the idea if he could put seven together, you're in a really good spot. For Oklahoma State, even, you know, if that means a few runs, so be it. You have to hope that your offense can answer that by the time that comes around. So I like it in the 6-7 range. I think he gives his best tonight. You know, we're expecting that. Certainly we've seen a lot of that from him this year, and he's been the go-to and I think as reliable as you can ask for on the mound, and that's what keeps a team like Oklahoma State comfortable. And when he does go out there, it's the guy that you know, okay, he's going to at least give us a chance. Out of anything else, you know, there's some guys, you know, if you do a whole staff thing or if you're on your second or third guy, you're like, yeah, he's going to, you know, if we get a good outing, so be it. That's great. But with Justin Campbell, it's like, we know we're going to have a shot. You know, if the bats come alive, we're going to be in a good position to win. And I think that goes without saying because of the offense, how strong they are. But six or seven, for sure, I like Justin Campbell, right? And it's going to be a really strong performance for him tonight.
So I'm sticking with baseball as well. I think we're probably all in agreement that this game's probably not going to start at 7:30.
No.
So over under, before, after, however you want to put it, Bedlam starts at 8:15.
Well, I'd buy that. I think that's probably about right. They're running, and Levi would just Ed and I during the break. We were adding up the times. Now, it's contingent on what's going on here. TCU and Kansas State are tied at 6 in the bottom of the 8th. And extra innings would certainly throw a kink into these plans. But basically, thanks to the first game, they're running about 45 to 50 minutes behind. So that would put it in the 8:15, 8:30 range. But I would say, just the way this tournament goes, I would sell it because I think it would be closer to 8:30 than it will be 8:15.
Yeah, I'm going to sell as well. We're going to go with a solid 8:25.
We're gonna
get ready and go 8:25 tonight, guys, on the dot, not a second later. So you better be out there and ready to go. We'll just call it right smack dab in the middle. So yeah, it's gonna be a true prime time. There's no doubt about that. But that to me is just how it should be.
Yeah, I'll take the over. I don't think we're gonna see 7:30. I think it'll be over 8:15. I could see 8:36. You know, 8:37 type of pitch. It'd be weird, you know, and that's if the weather stays away. I know there's like a slight chance a little bit later, but I don't think that'll be an issue. So
nah.
I would take the over on 8-15.
I'm sticking with baseball as well and going to the major leagues because we have a ton of talk on a lot of young guys right now, rightfully so, but one that I think kind of slides under the radar a little bit and probably shouldn't be, obviously, based off his production. Again, this season, coming into his own, and that's Vladimir Guerrero Jr., leading 16 home runs. He had another one yesterday. I think he had two yesterday, actually. And he's got 16 on the season now. Just a fun, obviously really intriguing talent to watch. His name alone. We saw him, the talk when he was in the minor. Like, he was coming out. He's going to dominate. And he certainly has done that again this year. So buy or sell, by the end of the season, he hits 40-plus home runs.
We got about, a month and a half for the All-Star break? I could buy 40. You know, it's funny. I saw something the other day. He was talking about, like, when he was coming up, he was overhyped. And then when he came in, he was overrated. And now he's underrated. You know, I don't know if he'll be as good as his dad before it's all said and done. But he's got a chance to be pretty damn good. And, if he's already at 16, I could – yeah, that's, 24 before the end of the year? I'll buy that.
And, Tom, as you know, part of the underrated – talk now and is because he doesn't get a lot of viewership being on the Blue Jays out of all teams.
And they can even play in their home park, for crying out loud, so they get even less. But I would say he'll have 24 more home run swings between now and the end of the year, and chances are they don't have to be they won't have to be good swings. We know he could take it out of the yard on a bad home run swing. So I would say 40 is certainly within reach between now and the end of the year, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. His strength is unreal, and he can go to any part of the park and take it over the fence. And he's so fun to watch because he is now becoming one of those guys where you're like, all right, every time he comes up, he has a chance to take it out, and we got to stop what we're doing and watch that. So I'm going to buy that too. I like him over 40. Simply based off the power alone, and we talk about launch angle and exit velocity and all that stuff. He's like he should probably write the book on all of that at this point, the way he hits bombs consistently. So, yeah, give me that big buy on those 40-plus.
Yeah, God, I hate analytics. Just do away with them.
Oh, they're pretty much evil. I agree. But yeah, it's
I understand the importance, but I don't need them. So I'm going back to Bedlam. Tom, you had mentioned you could possibly see this thing going extra innings. We've already seen a game, 3.5 hours. So I'm gonna set the bar a little high. Buy or sell, the game lasts four or more hours.
Wow, I have to sell that. I don't think it's going to go that long, but I think it's a done deal that it's going to be 3 hours plus, probably closer to 3:30 than it will be to 3. That's just the way college baseball games are right now. Even low-scoring games, and I don't know what you would qualify as low-scoring. We don't have 2-1 games anymore. So I would think it would go at least 3-3.
I think low-scoring in college would be anything combined less than 10.
Yeah, 5-4 games maybe would be low-scoring, something like that. Mm-hmm. But, I 4 hours, I hope not. I mean, that would get you into the wee hours, and the loser of this game sure wouldn't want to have to go back and play at 12:30 if they're leaving the park at 12:30. In the morning. So I would say that they're good enough that they'll have some quick innings, but there'll be some stretched out innings. But college baseball anymore, with the trips to the mound and runners and walks and all those things, I mean, you're going to get to 3 hours for sure. But I would say 4 hours is out. I don't know if it's out of the question, but I wouldn't buy that. I think it'd be closer to 3.5, and we'd be glad and call that a night.
Yeah, I'll sell over 4. I like it right about 3.5. I mean, you're pretty much guaranteed that with college baseball. And I would buy, probably be more inclined to buy, if I expected a lot of walks, a lot of different pitching changes, which I don't either of those things for tonight. So that means you're going to have a game that's probably got a good pace to it, got a good feel to it. I'm expecting, dare I say, classic, here, but it's going to be an intense matchup all the way through. With not a lot of stalling, not a lot of time wasted. So, yeah, give me that about 3.5 hours. It's what, 11:30 or something. Mm-hmm. Still not early by any means, yeah. but a late one. But it'll be worth it, I guarantee you that.
Yeah, I could see 3.5. But, I mean, if we start at 8:30, I mean, that's midnight. That's a long game. I would probably sell the 4 hours, but I wouldn't be surprised if they're pushing it. you know, because this Bedlam is always a high potent, high emotional type of game, especially when you got a chance to win a couple games and go to a championship. So I'd probably sell four, but I could see pushing it. I could see 3.5, 340 maybe, give or take.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that too. Tom, before we go to break, who do you have coming up on Where Are They Now today?
Well, we got somebody who knows about time and time of games, Gary Ward, who might have written the book on working a count and working pitch count to your favor. But Gary's going to join us. We're going to talk a lot about his recollection of some classic, and we won 16 conference championships in a row with him back in the day, and they were in Oklahoma City, and probably, and I'm guessing without looking, about half of them went through Oklahoma. We had to beat Oklahoma in one form or fashion or another, either in a winner's bracket or beat them on that loser's bracket or win two and break their hearts the way we used to do down there at All Sports Stadium. So we'll reminisce about that, but also want to get Gary's reaction to the celebration the other night, the celebration of Obreight. And having Bush and Mr. Obreight there and all that, and see what he thinks, see what he was watching and what he was feeling when he was watching.
It should be good stuff coming up at 5 o'clock right after the show here on Triple Play Sports Radio. Coming back on the afternoon sports drive, we'll take a look at a couple more Major League Baseball headlines. There are a couple guys that, man, they've made the news for various reasons, and one of them is dominating the other one. It's kind of a hilarious story. So we'll get all that underway next on the afternoon sports drive, as well as we'll get you an update on Oklahoma State Cowgirl Golf, where they sit right now for the NCAA Championship. All still to come, afternoon sports drive.
Good evening, everyone. We're going to be partly cloudy this evening. Overnight tonight, there is a slight chance of rain. Temperatures will be dropping down into the upper 60s. Tomorrow afternoon, we're expecting mostly cloudy skies, a chance of showers and storms in the afternoon, becoming even more likely, though. Later in the evening, and some of these storms do have the capability of becoming severe with up to golf ball-sized hail. Wind gusts of 70, so make sure you stay weather aware. Temperatures will top out in the middle 70s, and then on your Friday afternoon, highs make it into the low 70s under mostly cloudy skies. From the Newsline of Bob Mills Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Cassie Hyder.
The tooth of the mighty T-Rex is 4 feet long, but you only need 2 feet and two fists. Because you're a man, a Drumright Dental Center man, and you've never lost a fight to a dinosaur. Undefeated world champ, baby. Because when you're fighting a dinosaur, you gotta bite back. And that's why you need Drumright Dental Center. Strong teeth make strong men. Drumright Dental Center. Fight the dinosaur. Yeah. Don't bite dinosaurs.
At John Vance Chevrolet Buick GMC in Perry, the limited selection creates a sense of urgency. General Manager Rod Norris, why?
There's not a dealer out there that has a big selection. Right now, the inventory, because of the COVID shortages, the microprocessor shortages, the inventory has been very tight. So, you know, one of the things that we've had to stress and try to, you know, make sure all of our customers have understood is that if they see that vehicle online, if they see that vehicle when they're driving by the dealership, act quickly, because with the limited supply that everybody has right now, there's nothing that is setting for a long length of time. There's a little more urgency right now just because of the limited selection. We put our great prices out there on the internet. We have every vehicle advertised, and what we want is it to come in and be an easy, simple process.
John Vance Chevrolet Buick GMC, exit 186, I-35, Perry.
Check out all of our vehicles at vancechevrolet.net and like our page on Facebook.
John Vance Auto Group.
It's all true.
The Stillwater Mill and Agri Center in Stillwater, your headquarters for Happy Frog from Fox Farms Soil and Fertilizer Company. All your potted plants to serve the best. Happy Frog Potting Soil is perfect for all container plants outside on your porch or patio or inside your house. For additional nutrition and root efficiency, blend in Happy Frog fruit and flower fertilizer. Then sit back and enjoy the results. Fully stocked with a great variety of Happy Frog Potting Soils and organic fertilizers from Fox Farms. The Stillwater Mill and Agri Center, 502 E6. So much, much more than a feed store.
It's coming, the 62nd annual 101 Wild West Rodeo, sponsored by Osage Casino, Leaf Kings, Ram Trucks, CFM Corporation, HRI Remodeling, and Budweiser. June 10th, 11th, and 12th at the Rodeo Grounds Ash in Prospect, Ponca City, featuring the annual free rodeo barbecue June 10th with advanced ticket purchase. Thursday night, June 10th is Tough Enough to Wear Pink Night, and it's family night with kids 12 and under getting in free. Free concerts and rodeo dance every night under the stars at the Rodeo Grounds. Grounds featuring Matt Williams Thursday night, June 10th, The Great Divide Friday night, June 11th, and Saturday night, Jeremy Studdard. This year, the rodeo features three-time PRCA Specialty Act of the Year, Tomas Garcilaso. Nightly giveaways, too. Get a numbered souvenir program for your chance to win. Plus, the nightly gun giveaway from Good Old Boys Guns and Ammo. Advance tickets on sale now at Equity Bank, Tractor Supply, RCB Bank, and the Ponca City Chamber of Commerce. For online tickets and more information, visit 101wildwestrodeo.com. Cimarron Medical Services presents another sleep apnea workshop Wednesday, June 9th in the parking lot from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Bring your equipment to have the pressure checked. And with a current prescription, you can pick up replacement supplies. Cleansing wipes and mask liners will be 25% off. Cleaning devices at 10% off in the parking lot of Cimarron Medical Services. Wednesday, June 9th from 10 to 3, just west of Stillwater Medical Plaza on 12th Street. Insurance and prescription restrictions may apply.
At Central Rural Electric Cooperative, we take our job of providing safe, affordable, and reliable electricity seriously. Remember to look up, look around, and be aware of power lines at all times. Thinking about planting a tree or doing other maintenance work around your home or business? Call Oki before you dig to locate any underground power lines. Visit our website, www.mycentral.coop, for more safety information. Central Rural Electric Cooperative is an equal opportunity employer and provider.
This is another good song.
It's another good song. Wow.
Let this one play too.
Wow. I think we're back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster.
You know what we did? We just turned you guys completely off so I could listen to the music, and then we figured we'd have you come
back
later.
Well, that's what I was saying.
I was hoping that Levi would have just restarted the Beach Boys because that'd have been super solid.
What I was saying was that it's interesting on Wednesdays when Levi is in studio because you know if I don't have Tom's music in there. Tom probably gives the executive order, you go find that music and you put it in there. And Levi has no choice but to listen and go do it. And then it pops up, you know, inexplicably on the break. And I have no choice but to address it as well because it's such a difference.
We thought we played the Beach Boys for Justin Campbell, the California dude. You know, he's a...
That's my grandpa's favorite band. I love them. I could listen to them every single day.
Let me tell you, you can tell your family now, not this week, Zach, not this Sunday, although we'll probably play some summertime. They may be in there somewhere this weekend on the jukebox. But next Sunday is just a Beach Boys Sunday. All the Beach Boys stuff I could find.
I'm gonna get a little table. I'm going to get some lawn chairs. I'm going to get one of those little tabletop gas grills. And I'm going to sit outside the station under those speakers. I'm going to make some tiki drinks.
So Tom, what you're telling me is that day that I won't be allowed to call in and request something other than Beach Boys? Mm.
Well, no.
We'll get a little inflatable pool.
You could call it. No, we're going to be up at the pool. We opened in the pool this week.
Oh, the rooftop. Yeah, that's right. They opened it back up. It's Memorial Weekend.
We've got some dress standards for you guys, but you can come to the pool anyway. I mean, let's not embarrass us all.
Dressed.
Yeah, no speedos involved
okay.
for you guys.
Okay.
Well, I'm not showing up then, so.
Oh, okay.
I'm not showing up.
Thank God.
Yeah, keep that image in your mind. Yeah, I know. So here in the Afternoon Sports Drive, we're live from Brown's Bottle Shop, and you can come in and check out all of their new beers they have available this spring. They have new Pilsners, too, Blondes, Pale Ales, Lagers, and from Ballast Point, Black Mesa, Nine Bands Brewing, many more. Available here at Brown's Bottle Shop. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado. So a couple more headlines kind of out of Major League Baseball. It's been floating around. Actually, before I do that, let me go ahead and give an update for OSU Cowgirl Golf real quick because they are currently up 3-2 right now in the NCAA Championship against Ole Miss and just really getting underway. If you are listening, you're like, man, where can I find that? You can check it out on Golf Channel.
I was going to say, it's on Golf Channel. You can also get it on golfstat.com.
Yeah, on golfstat.com, and live scoring. But it is viewable on Golf Channel if you have that. So there's your quick update, obviously, going on right now. All right, so out of Major League Baseball, I think it's at this point starting to get a little bit more recognition, but I don't know, honestly, how this isn't one of the most talked about and most – well-known topics in sports as we speak, because what Shohei Ohtani is doing at this point in Major League Baseball is just unbelievable. 15 home runs. It seems like every single game he's going out there hitting a home run. We know he's at times can be really good on the mound. He's had some issues here and there. But the fact that he can do both at such a high level. I mean, Tom, have you ever personally, have you ever seen anyone do what Shohei Ohtani is doing this year?
Well, the fact that he can do it on the mound and do it at the bat and do it with such authority, if you will. I mean, you could say it's kind of a gimmick thing, but he's more than a gimmick. I mean, he's a dual threat every time he comes to the yard. And he could be a major threat if he just was one or the other, right? I mean, if he didn't hit, if he just pitched, or vice versa. I can't remember anybody who, you know, we've had people who tried it before, but this guy is just, he's just so impressive doing both that he's one of those guys, every time he swings, you think it's going out, right? And when he's pitching, he's going to keep you in the game. What a rare combination of talent. So I guess I'd have to say I don't remember anybody being this good doing both.
So the question is then for both of you, do you think that this ushers in this new, you know, for scouts, where they're constantly on the lookout now for guys that are like, okay, you know, they can do both. We've seen them do that at different levels. But can they? Are they going to be out there looking for that next guy that can do both consistently at the major league level, which we know is extremely rare and extremely difficult? But is that now becoming the new trend maybe for scouts on the lookout for these guys?
I could see them keeping an eye out. I wouldn't think that they're going to go out of their way to try to find a you know, the dual threat two-way player. But I could see them keeping an eye out and putting out feelers, you know, in certain regions, like, hey, if you've got a kid that can do both, you know, send us some tape, or, you know, point us in his direction and we'll keep an eye out. But I think players like that are I don't want to say like incredibly rare, but I mean, you don't see it often, you know, maybe at lower levels, but would they be good enough to make it at this level? So I could see him keeping an eye out for him, but I don't know if they're going to become incredibly prevalent, because if they were, then this wouldn't be the first real occurrence that we've seen.
I'm with you, Zach. I mean, you're always looking for that guy, right? Be they here or overseas, or, you know, playing in different leagues, and then maybe on the globe, there may be two or three more out there somewhere. But I don't think that they're as commonplace as you would think, where if you just showed up at a college game or a summertime game, you're going to see one of these guys do it. Now, high schoolers, we all have that going, right? If you can throw it over the plate and you can hit it out of the yard, we'll put you at third base or shortstop, and you'll be a two-way
Houston
player.
Houston Moral.
Yeah, but I don't think you're going to have that kind of a impressive combo like you got with him. I won't say it's a once-in-a-lifetime deal, but I will say it's so rare that when it happens, it opens your eyes every time you see him play.
Maybe once in a generation, potentially.
Well, then maybe the question should be, will we see more players then coming up through systems focusing on trying to do that?
I would agree with that. I think we could see, and it may not be super prevalent in the States. I think probably more relevant overseas or in other countries. But I think you certainly could see high school players like a Houston Moral, because if you can consistently hit 93, 94, 95 every single pitch, you know, and it were more prevalent, let's say Ohtani came around 6 years ago, right? And he's at the height of his game 6 years ago. You could see guys like Houston Moral, like, you know, getting more looks than, okay, well, we're going into the eighth inning and we've got a big series coming up next week and it's a midweek game, so we need to throw you out there to save some arms. I could see more guys like that potentially, you know, hey, I was a good pitcher in high school. I was a good hitter in high school. Hey, Josh, do you think I could throw a couple of games here and there? So I would agree with that. I think it could be more prevalent moving forward. I don't know if you'll ever get a guy. It would be rare to get a guy on Ohtani's level, but I think it could be more prevalent with guys trying.
I'm going to walk you guys way, way back before some of you, maybe either one of you were born, but Darren Dilks is a name that will come to mind for a lot of our Oklahoma State fans. And Dilks, he was that way. He was a heck of a pitcher, and he was a DH, and he could hit the heck out of the ball. And he was dangerous on both sides of that equation. And we rode him a lot back in the 80s when he was here, in the early 80s. One of the few that I can recall that was that impressive. But I'll throw this out. you know, having coached at a high school level and certainly up in this area, every position player thinks he can pitch and every pitcher thinks he can hit, okay? So now whether you can do it or not and can actually get it done when the lights are on, that's usually a different story like Ohtani can do. So I'm not saying he's the only one in baseball who can do it, but I bet you wouldn't count too many on two hands that could do it like he does.
I love the irony of a pitching DH.
Yeah, I know. Well, and for a guy like Ohtani, what stands out so much about him is that it's his hitting ability. Yeah. It's because he's actually such a good hitter and takes that so serious. Like, you know, we see a lot of pitches outside even that the guys are trying to go way out on him, and he's pulling them. He's, like, yanking them into the stands at 100-plus miles an hour because of his power and his reach and all that. So, yeah, you know, as far as that, you know, physical specimen, it's probably going to be potentially a once-in-generation type thing. But I'm with you guys. I could see this being more of a focus for guys, especially, I mean, way young.
Yeah.
You know, the idea of, hey, let me get this kid into pitching, and then we'll, of course, have him hit like normal, and you never know. You might run into it someday.
Well, and that's where it's kind of – because you get these places, these like, little league academies, almost, if you will.
Right.
That the competition level is certainly – I think the level of competition in Little League Baseball is certainly a lot higher than it was when I was in Little League Baseball. We were really good. We were one of the best teams in the state. But I think across the board, you know, they're trying too much with these kids. You're seeing a lot of high school kids, and it's been prevalent for a while, but you're seeing a lot of high school kids having to have Tommy John surgery because you're getting these kids throwing 150 pitches, you know, in two games, and you're 9 years old. I guarantee you're going to get these guys that are the hard O's that couldn't make it. In the, you know, they're the little league coaches, and you're going to have kids that are, you know, and it's that's little league. You get kids that are second basemen and pitchers, but I could see it being more and more prevalent. The World Series rings for winning a, you know, a 6-team tournament in the middle of Stroud.
Hey, let me update you guys just on people who. I'm wondering when to head to Oklahoma City, because I would say go right now if you're going.
Yeah.
But the game, TCU beat Kansas State 7-6 on a walk-off in the bottom of the ninth. So the Frogs move ahead to the winner's bracket game against Tech at 4, and it'll be a purple, well, kind of a purple thing. K-State and Baylor at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning in a loser's bracket game. But what I was about to say, the game ended about 4:30, okay? And the next one up was supposed to have started at 4, Texas and West Virginia. And that's probably not going to get going until about 5:15. So you could see as the day has gone on, more time has been added to the actual first pitch for the 7:30 game. So I would guess it's probably, as we were talking before, probably closer to 8:30 than it will be to 8. And hopefully that's the case. But it won't be like it was 1 year when Frank was here. We actually started a game at 10:05. And we were the last game to be played that game. We had some rain. We had some extra inning stuff.
The,
and we started
the game
at 10:05. Game,
was it 2017 that or 2016, 2017 when OSU went to Fayetteville for a regional?
Uh huh.
It was the Bedlam game before the Big 12 tournament. I think Oklahoma State had to win. Oklahoma State had to beat OU to make the Big 12 tournament.
That's correct, yes.
And then they had to win the Big 12 tournament to make Fayette. Mm-hmm. But didn't that game was rain-delayed, wasn't it? Wasn't there like a three-hour rain delay?
Yeah, I want to
say it was.
And
they didn't start till like 9:30, 9:45 or something. The game ended like 2 in the morning.
Yeah, as I recall, that's right. It was a rain situation there. Fortunately, we haven't had the rain.
Yeah.
But when you try to schedule 4 games, you know, and they're starting at 9 o'clock, which is not exactly an ideal start time for a baseball game, but you're doing about all you can other than you don't have 4 in one day and you split it up mm-hmm. even further. But, you know, the final game, you're at the mercy of what goes on, obviously, and we have no idea what the personality of the Texas-West Virginia game is going to be. You would hope it's quick, in and out, and let's go. But we're backed up a good, if you start adding up the first two games of the day, we're probably backed up a good 2 hours, I would think.
Coming up next on the Afternoon Sports Drive, we will finish out the show and we'll tell you what we learned here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Welcome back into the Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Tom Dorado, and Levi Peckinpah here at Brown's Bottle Shop, 128 North Main. Make sure you come in and check out all of the beers, wines, spirits, and pre-mixed cocktails they have available ready to go and get you into these warmer months ahead. You can match the weather with whatever drink you want here at Brown's Bottle Shop. To finish out the show, we're going to tell you what we learned.
The day is coming to an end. Time to find out if these two got any smarter. Let's find out what the guys learned today on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Well, well, I learned something today.
Well, I learned, I've got a little golf topic here, believe it or not. But before I do, I will update everybody once again. Right now, it's a 2-2 tie between Ole Miss and Oklahoma State girls golf there in the NCAA championship. So sticking with golf. Found out today that the match is indeed back.
Yeah, it is.
The match will return on July 6th. That will be in Montana. But this time it's going to be Tom Brady and Phil Mickelson. And they're going to take on Aaron Rodgers and Bryson DeChambeau, who has also now become a meme in the last couple of days, but was already a big name in golf, but is now a meme with Brooks Koepka, which is hilarious. Obviously, Tiger Woods can't be a part of it. After his injury and stuff too, but this is great. You know, I already think we saw Tom Brady's post on Twitter. He is just trolling everybody immediately. That one was too good. The one you sent me. Let me bring that one up because that one was amazing. He had like three memes that he created himself,
like back to back,
Yeah, this was the one he, and it was of course Brooks Koepka and Bryson DeChambeau with the meme, and you've got him looking really upset, and it says Aaron Rodgers. You know, like the face of like. Oh, got to be kidding me. And on the back it says the Packers kicking a field goal when they're down 7. I mean that's so good on so many levels, because of course, you know, Tom Brady was playing against him in that game. He gets the football back and then he makes that meme. I'm like, Tom Brady, so not only does he win championships, so he wins Twitter. Okay.
Did you see the caption of the Instagram post?
I have not seen that one.
So he shares the photo, yep, the match.
Yep.
And Brady's caption is two champions versus a scientist and a Jeopardy host.
Oh, man, that's so good. Yeah, there you go. Tom Brady, yeah. Phil Mickelson against Aaron Rodgers and Bryson DeChambeau, July 6th. The match is back, this time in Montana. Should be a lot of fun.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going boxing, if you can call it that, I guess. Love him or hate him, Logan Paul, the Paul brothers are just geniuses. Absolutely brilliant people. They're in this for money, right? There's no question about it. You know, sure, they want to win some fights, but they're in it for money. A person has purchased 4 ringside seats to the Floyd Mayweather Logan Paul fight coming up on StubHub for a total of $87,000. That's an insane,
wow,
amount of money. And it's funny because there's a website, betonline.ag.
Yep.
And they tweeted out $87,000 on Logan Paul to defeat Floyd Mayweather would pay $609,000.
Oh.
Yeah.
Like, by the way, in case anyone wants to throw that
bet
down.
If you wanted to drop $87,000 on our website, we'll pay you $609,000.
I had to jump on.
Yeah, no, that's crazy. Yeah, so the Paul brothers, not a fan of them, but I got to respect them because they're doing what Conor McGregor did when McGregor fought Mayweather, and McGregor is set for life.
Yeah, they're certified morons, but they're making a lot of money.
A lot of money.
Tommy D, what'd you learn today?
Well, I tell you, I've learned it over the last couple of days, so I'll just let you guys know today. It's anything's possible in today's Major League Baseball. Anything, and I underline anything, that you can have 17 guys on the IL, you can have your multi-trillion-dollar hitter hitting 186 and still able to win games with a triple-A roster like the Mets are doing. It just amazes me that they can even get through a game when you've got, I was telling you the other day, they've got 7 starters out of the game, 7 guys who would trot out on the field and start tonight if they were healthy, a couple of pitchers, and plus your trillion-dollar man is hitting 186, and somehow they're still winning ball games. So I learned anything is possible in today's Major League Baseball.
That is true.
Does at what point, or is there a point, Trey Cobb gets pulled up to the majors this year?
Well, I think there's probably,
because he's close,
a chance. He's been in and out of good outings. You know, he's had one, maybe 2 good ones and 2 that were less than good. You know, he's at AAA, so you're going against guys who can hit the ball and put it in play. I think his overall, you know, if you just want to go on numbers, and some they do, some they don't, but I think his ERA in four appearances is about six. So, and that's the result of one bad outing. So, I mean, that could happen to a reliever. But I do think he's still in favorable condition there. And even though he can't go from AA, but he can be moved up to AAA, then be called up. I tell you who's making a hell of a run. It's Carson Teal. Teal in AA at Harrisburg has been out three times as a starter. Now, his team can't score. He's 0-2. But that they don't look at that. But he's got an ERA of 2.35 in three starts, and he's gone six innings each game. Now, that to me says, you know what, about one more of those, young man, and we'll put you up to the AAA of the Nationals and see what you could do there, and then you can get called up. So, you know, it's a shame that Trey ran into a little bit of hard luck his second outing of the year. But I don't think that they just hold that against you either. I mean, they want to see how you – if you can get guys out, they feel good about it, and the Mets' pitching situation is so in flux anyway that it's probably a good situation for Trey if you just get hot again.
So I had pulled this up earlier, and this was what I was going to do before I found the $87,000 for four tickets. Tom, I don't know if you've seen them, but we talked yesterday about the new era Major League, the local market caps they came out with. They're just absolutely atrocious. They feature a local landmark of whatever team there is, you know, and they've got the zip code or the area codes of that's around the teams and all that. Well, they're just god awful, Tom. When you get a chance to take a look at them, a new era has pulled those hats. They are no longer selling those hats. They lasted less than 24 hours because, God, they're bad. To give you an example, the Royals, the four or five area codes that are on the Royals hats are all in Kansas. There's not one Missouri area code.
Oh,
by the way, the Royals play in Missouri. So, little stupid.
I still feel like there's this group of fans, a group of people actually out there.
Bad.
There's this group of people that still don't know if you had to ask them for sure if the Royals and the Chiefs play in Kansas or Missouri. They wouldn't know.
Oh, Kansas City. They play in Kansas City, which is in Kansas, right?
Yeah. I'm telling you, they would not know.
Well, it's like Ark City, Arkansas City. That's clearly in Arkansas.
Yeah.
That's not
Missouri
that's
in Missouri.
That's not just north of the Oklahoma border in Kansas.
Come on, people. Yeah. Come on. All right, Levi, I know you got something too. What'd you learn today?
Oh, well, I learned two things. For one thing, the White Sox had to let St. Louis off easy for a day. So I learned that the White
Sox. Is
that
Sox what it was?
I'm joking.
I think it was Tommy Edman going yard twice out of all people.
Yeah, Edman
even had the pitcher's hat confiscated for cheating.
The one guy in the lineup you wouldn't expect to hit two bombs hits two bombs. How about that?
Yeah, he went insane today. I will not lie about that. But hey, I mean, still winning the series 2-1. I'll put that for the White Sox. They did good the past two games.
Uh-huh.
Give up one. I'm fine with that. But over in the NFL, we kind of already figured that he was retired, but officially gave it today on the Pat McAfee Show. The most scoring person in NFL history, Adam Vinatieri, has officially retired after 24 years in the NFL. Four rings, certified NFL Hall of Famer. First ballot, easy.
Wow. Yeah, when I saw his number of points, it was over 2,600, I believe is what it was. That's, wow. Yeah, 24 seasons. And as Zach, you told me, the one position you can do that at would be kicker. But he's been he was as reliable of a kicker that you'll ever find. May not find anyone better than that ever. But, yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, Levi. That's a crazy career right there. You could say you were in the NFL when you were in the late 40s. That's unbelievable.
Does the number four by Adam Vinatieri get retired by both the Patriots and the Colts?
For sure the Colts. I could see maybe the Patriots, but
I
don't know.
Yeah, I'm probably on that too. I mean, it's – man, it probably should. It probably should if you think about it. That's going to be – well, I was about to say that'd be a kicker number anyways, but now with the new number rules, anybody can wear it now. But, yeah, I would go ahead and lean that way. Why not?
I mean, because without him, there's a lot of things that change in NFL history. I mean, especially a couple kicks for the Patriots. But, I mean, Adam Vinatieri, the best kicker of all time, and that's going to be a mantle – at least for a couple decades, I don't know if anybody's going to be able to live up to. I mean, you have Harrison Bucker, you have Justin Tucker, you have the next generation in, and the guy that they looked up to and they chased for so long is officially gone, and now we see that big comparison of those guys right now, but the long legacy that Adam Vinatieri leaves.
Yep, it's one that's really unbelievable. That's really cool to see him finally get to call it a career. This has been the Afternoon Sports Drive. Thanks to Brown's Bridal Shop. Come check them out at 128 North Main. That's Tom Dorado, Levi Peckinpah, and Zach Lancaster, and I'm Patrick Wheeler. Where are they now? Tom has Gary Ward coming up next year on Triple Play Sports Radio.